morning. It is a beautiful day, but it's raining out there this morning. So be careful if you're going to leave the house. We think most of you that go to work, now that we're on this little bit later hour, we think most of you that go to work are probably already gone. But some of you are lingering around the house and you're about to head out, and it's slippery out on the street, and there's a lot of accidents out there today. I saw a big one as I came out on Lebanon Road toward the Hermitage area, and so be careful as you come near the Hermitage area, because there's some cars and ambulances all over the place down there. We're glad to have you with us this morning. For those of you that are watching us on 39 and don't know, we're on Viacom, and have been for a couple of days now, they tell me, since 4 o'clock in the morning on August the 31st, and that is a big step for us. 21, we've come of age. And channel 21 now, for those of you that have Viacom, if you want to switch over, that is a very clear channel. And for the rest of you, we're still 39 out here, and we love having you on with us every day on the Morning Edition. And we have some special people that are going to be around today. Steve Camp is a contemporary Christian artist. A lot of you know him from years ago. We're going to play an older video of his. He says that's not him anymore, and we're going to find out who he is now, Steve Camp. Also, I had a lady walk up to me last night at my church, and a very wonderful, faithful lady that watches the show every day, and she said, oh, I just hung on every word that your guest was saying yesterday. A lady of great faith was on the show, Barbara Robinson, and my friend said, I wish that I could hear more of her story. And that was just a confirmation of what we had already done. We decided to have Barbara Robinson come back and tell more of that incredible story, because we sort of ran out of time before you heard the most important part. Barbara Robinson, of course, is the lady from the country of Lebanon. She and her husband went there, started a children's home, were accused of sedition, some political acts, and her husband was shot to death within yards of where she and a bunch of children that they were raising were singing hymns. And today we're going to hear the rest of that story. And also Barbara Robinson will have with her Laverne Barton, who was also with us. She's a well-known realtor in the area. And we better go to our devotional so we can get all of this show in today, and we'll be right back.
What a wonderful world. You looked at our world lately. On the surface, it doesn't look like such a wonderful place, does it? With all the pollution and crime and hatred around, we may think that this world is kind of a pretty ugly place in which to live. But you know, that's not the world that God created for us. In the first chapter of Genesis, in the 31st verse, we learn that God made the heavens and earth, and after he had made them, he looked at everything that he had made, and it was good. This means that everything God created in heaven and earth, including you and me, he made good. I saw a bumper sticker one time that said, God don't make no junk, and that's true. He made you, and he made me. He made this world, and he created us good. The problem is that we haven't taken very good care of what God has made. We've messed up the world in a lot of ways, polluting our streams and air, killing our vegetation and wildlife, and worst of all, allowing human life to be destroyed through poverty and hatred and war. We must remember that all of life is sacred because God created it that way. He made everything good. And when you look at our world in that way, it does seem like a wonderful world, doesn't it? I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world God has made. Oh, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Before you see the man called Steve Camp, I want you to see something of what he used to be, he says. And we're going to show a video here in a minute. He's a Warner Alliance recording artist. He's a Grammy Award winner. He's been nominated many times for Dove Awards and 14 albums and more. And he's got a brand new album. We're going to hear about that today. But there's a lot more to Steve Camp than just singing or writing. He's a very involved Christian man. And let's see who he used to be.
Between God and herself, it ain't the business.
was you.
Yes, hi. Just a few short years ago.
Steve Camp, how long ago was that?
I think it was, we were having a little debate while it was running. I think it was 85, it could have been 86, but I think it was about 1985. Well, so 8-9 years ago.
You've come a long, long way from there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was just a wee pup back then.
You didn't even want us to show that yeah. video so much.
Why? Well, you know, it was filmed under some awkward circumstances. I was in Dallas, Texas, and we're hearing the rain, I guess.
Yes, we are.
I was in Dallas, Texas. It was about 105 degrees outside, 110 degrees. It was a typical humid, hot Texas day, and then being in a bus where they couldn't run the air conditioner because it was making too much noise and so forth. So it was just it was one of those things. I probably lost 10 pounds that day. That was the only positive thing I felt came from that.
Gosh, I should have been there.
Yeah. But it was a fun time. The people were great to work with and so forth. But there was a song on that same album called Shake Me to Wake Me that I really wanted to do a video on called Stranger to Holiness. I guess I'm more noted for my ballads. Mm-hmm. And that's a song that has still stood the test of time and gets requests now. Where Lazy Jane, I think, was a nice cutesy kind of a song for then, but I just wanted another song being done. But thank you for sure. I haven't seen that in a long time.
Well,
so.
It was kind of fun. But it, yeah. Who was Lazy Jane? Was she somebody?
Not, you know, it was just a generic person. Myself and Rob Frazier, I know you've had on before, co-wrote the song. We've been songwriting buddies for about 11, 12 years now.
Oh, yeah, he's great.
And, he's a great talent. And we just thought, growing up in Wheaton, Illinois, where I'm from, many people call it the Vatican II, because of all the Christian organizations that are there. We have more churches than fire hydrants, I think, in this town. And it's a wonderful place to be from. It really is. It's a great heritage. We have a lot of good religious works based out of there. However, in the scope of that, I think where Christianity is plentiful, it tends to make people, rather than more excited about their faith, sometimes it can make people lukewarm in their faith. So I was just kind of remembering a lot of friends that I used to have that were so inundated with Christian things and a Christian entities and Christian subcultural language and so forth, that rather than being salt and light to a dying world, they just became comfortable.
Yes.
And
just kind of settle into the church.
Just kind of settled in. Amy had a song about this called Fat Baby many years ago.
Yes.
So this was kind of my version of Fat Baby, where someone can just be a Lazy Jane. They can be so comfortable in their faith that it doesn't move them to further conviction and further serving the Lord. It moves them to a real lackadaisical, dormant attitude. And so this was about waking up some of the sleepy saints, as it were. So.
Sleepy saints, all
yes.
right. How has Steve Camp changed from that point to this? And I know that's a long process.
Yeah.
But how has it changed your music?
Well, I think over the last 5 or 6 years, there's been a more sober-mindedness on my faith mm-hmm. and on using music to really glorify the Lord. I think in the early days there was more of an entertainment aspect to it, and music in itself is a very entertaining field, and so I'm not denying the fact that people should enjoy themselves at the concerts. We have a lot of fun at the concerts that I do, but I think then that there was more of an emphasis on the entertainment than there was on the ministry, and that's really changed. A friend of mine, Dr. John MacArthur, has had a profound impact on my life, as well as my family. My mom, Ruth, is a delightful mom. She's one of my best friends as well. Mm-hmm. Not too many kids can say that about their mom.
How
but she's
wonderful.
Also discipled me. My wife, Kim, is the same thing. Being married the last 6 years, having four kids in the last 4.5 years, has made a real difference in my life, because it brings you to a place where you're not walking around both feet planted firmly in midair, but it brings you to a place of real sober-mindedness, of real solidness in the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And so the emphasis has been more from entertainment and the emphasis on the music to now the emphasis on the Word of God and really trying to communicate the truths of Scripture through song. One of my favorite verses, Susan, is a verse out of Psalm 119. It's verse 54, and it says, "Thy statutes are my songs, in the house of my pilgrimage. And that's what I really want to do with my life. I want to take God's word and build it into God's people, to make His word their music, His theology, as it were, their doxology. And that's been a big change in emphasis for me. So I teach, it seems like, as much these days as I sing, even though I still do about 100 to 120 concerts a year.
Oh my goodness. You were known as a very dogmatic kind of a person.
Yeah, I still am.
Are you?
Yes.
<Okay. laughs>
Very much so.
Very dogmatic.
Yeah.
And I was reading in some of the promo that came over from your office from David Filson that you had kind of changed from telling people what was wrong with what they were doing to kind of getting to where what was right about
My spiritual gift, I'm an exhorter. I'm an elbow in the body of Christ, just saying, don't forget, wake up. And sometimes as an exhorter, it's easy to point the finger. And it's easy to say, get right with the Lord, serve Him with holiness and obedience, and be true to God's word. And I still say those things very passionately and very dogmatically and very profoundly. But at the same time, I learned this last record, it's easier to point the finger than it is to extend the hand.
Yes.
And this last year, I'm learning to walk with people, not just exhort them. In other words, if I exhort someone, I better be prepared to walk with them and to serve them. And so, you know, there's an example of this in the Bible where Paul and Barnabas were having a huge debate over John Mark. As you know, Mark was trying to serve the Lord, and he wiped out in the crucial moment. And both of these great men of God were right. Paul was concerned about the work, and Barnabas was concerned about the worker. And so here, at the end of Paul's life in 2 Timothy, he says, by the way, bring John Mark, because he's profitable for service. And you always have to wonder, well, how did he get that way? Mm-hmm. It wasn't because of Paul, and I really relate more to Paul. I'm very choleric in my personality.
Yeah, me too.
And so I relate more to Paul, where I'm concerned about the work, and I have very little tolerance for incompetence. And I feel like people excuse a lot of their life of incompetency and relate it to the Lord, and that really bothers me. I feel the Lord deserves a well-disciplined, self-controlled, meaningful life, not a life where we call on God as some Hertz renegade and say, boy, I've messed up again, and I'll just excuse that under the guise of grace.
But you and I can kind of roll over some people.
We can roll over some people very easily and without knowing it.
Mm-hmm.
Many times when I think I'm being a blessing to people, they're offended.
I know.
So,
do you
know the feeling?
Yeah.
And so here, for myself, this last year, I'm learning to be more of a Barnabas figure. Barnabas was more concerned about the worker, and there is a definite balance. And I'm learning that balance in my life right now, to be very honest. I'm learning what it means to care for the individual, hopefully without letting the work suffer. It's a life of one another's. And as I've studied this last year, there are 42 one another's in the New Testament. To care for one another, love one another, serve one another, to bear one another's burdens. That's the process of discipleship.
Maybe you need to write a book about that, Steve.
Yes.
One another's.
Yeah, it would be wonderful, because so much of the church today, I feel, is consumed with self, only self-esteem. As John likes to say, is self-esteem only good for self? Shouldn't self-esteem be beneficial for others? Mm-hmm. And it's the point of all spiritual gifts, isn't it? 1 Peter 4:10, where Peter says, each one has been given a gift by the manifold grace of God, and we are to serve each other with that gift. So the purpose of all even spiritual gifts is to serve one another.
Mm-hmm.
And the church is just inundated with a self-absorbed psycho theology, as it were, psychobabble today, that only wants to focus in on themselves, their own pain, their own woundedness, their own cares, rather than saying, you know, I'm here to give my life away to the needs of others. So I'm in the process of learning that, rather than just telling people to get right with God, to show them the ways how, and that the Great Commission in Matthew 28 is fulfilled in living out the two great commandments, to love Him with every fiber of our being, heart, soul, mind, and strength, but then to learn to love our neighbor as ourself. To make disciples doesn't come through saying, get it right. It comes through extending the hand and let's walk together as we grow in Christ. Let's do it together.
Right.
Yeah.
This is so great. We have just such a short time here to talk about some things.
I know, I'm very long-winded, so we have a problem.
Well, this is wonderful. I needed this morning, so you're saying some things that come right to me. And I know your family is deep in your heart, and your wife, Kim, is probably a good balance.
Yeah, it was just about 10 days ago that we had our fourth child.
Yes.
And his name is Marshall William Paul Camp. And we have a little four-year-old boy named Maxfield Stephen, a little two-and-a-half-year-old boy named Johnston Daniel. Hi, guys, if you're watching. And we have a little one-and-a-half-year-old little girl named Jordan Ruth. She is just beautiful and a sweetheart, like my wife. She's Kim. Is I've kind of punted beyond my coverage, as they say. She is a wonderful, beautiful lady, the real heart of our home. And even though I'm the head of our home, as she likes to remind me, she's the neck that turns the head.
Yes.
And so it's a pleasure to be married to her. And so, yeah, my heart's really with my family these days. It's real exciting to grow with them. And all the respect for women that give up their time to be the heart of the home again. I know that's frowned upon today, but boy, our kids thrive because they have a mom that has really given of her life for them.
Yes. You've given your heart to a lot of causes, too.
Yeah.
One of them is called CAUSE.
Yeah. Compassion International, if you're familiar with them. I've sponsored kids with them for about 12 years now and have been a full-time spokesperson for them for over 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a group, you know, during the mid-80s or so forth, when all of the pop artists were getting together in the country artists, the USA for Africa, and Band-Aid and all of the hunger projects, I thought, you know, the church has been involved in feeding the poor for thousands of years.
Mm-hmm.
But here, what a great idea to get the industry together. So I was with Sparrow Records at that time. Billy Ray Hearn is godparents to my kids. And I called him on the phone. I said, Billy Ray, would you be interested if we put together the Christian response to this? I thought it was a great idea Bob Geldof had. Mm-hmm. Would you be interested in sponsoring that? He says, by all means, you organize it, we'll release it. So we had the largest gathering out of all the artists. We had about 110, 120 artists out, and the most wide, diverse group of people. Doug Oldham to Amy Grant to Sandy Patty to Rez Band, you know, to, I mean, all kinds. It was just a wonderful group of men and women that came together from Evie Torenquist to Larry Norman. And we sang a song called Do Something Now in order to encourage people to not forget the poor. And it wasn't to say that the church hasn't done anything at all. It was simply a gentle reminder. And I tell you, the wonderful thing that we can praise the Lord for, Susan, is that though Band-Aid raised tens of millions of dollars, very little of that money, according to the trades and the reports, got actually to the kids.
Mm-hmm.
With Compassion, 100% of the money raised went directly to the child. The benefit, too, was that we received several thousand sponsors. I think it was 6,000 or 7,000 sponsors of individual children.
Mm-hmm.
The average sponsor for Compassion lasts about 7 to 8 years. So here, even though this hasn't been a hot item in the media, here you see the church quietly, faithfully, diligently going about its business in being serving the Lord through loving their neighbor, through helping other people, especially the kids in third world countries. So it was a wonderful project to be associated with.
And there's another project. I think one of my favorite songs that you have written, and you've written so many that our listeners would know, one of them is Do You Feel the Pain? And that was a kind of a corporate project for singers and all too. But you gave all of that money, all of the royalties from that, to ACCT.
That's right, AIDS Crisis in Christians Today.
Yes.
I wanted to, along with Dr. Tony Campolo, we started a ministry, an awareness ministry to the local church, to people that have AIDS. I have to say at the top, we do not condone homosexuality, bisexuality, promiscuity among heterosexuals, illegal IV drug use. But we thought at the same time, we cannot condone our self-righteous attitudes that prohibit us from dying people from sharing the gospel. The little phrase that we coined in our organization says this: His holiness not compromised, yet His mercy not restrained. In other words, God has a standard of holiness that cannot be violated.
That's right.
At the same time, His mercy should not be restrained from people that need a Savior. They don't need our fear and condemnation. They need Jesus Christ. And so we've been able to put on several awareness concerts around the country. We work with a wonderful group of men and women called ASAP, Americans for a Sound AIDS Policy. Nita and Shepard Smith that are wonderful. They're providing a real mandate legislatively and politically for the Christians, for the conservatives in the country. But we just want to help dying people. And the parable of the Good Samaritan is so pointed, isn't it? When the rich young lawyer there was trying to trap Jesus in a clever argument of who is my neighbor, our Lord just cut through the contemporary fog that most people live in even today. And he basically said this: anybody in our path in need is our neighbor. Think about it. Could you see the Lord refusing compassion or mercy from someone who is dying? It'd be unthinkable. And if we are to be demonstrating Jesus Christ to a lost world, we ought to go to anybody in our path in need, whether they have AIDS or not,
right,
and share the gospel. We have seen many people with AIDS come to the Lord. Do I have time to share a very quick story, or are we out of time?
Well, we're about out of time.
We're out of time. Just to let people know, regardless of whatever circumstance you find yourself in then, that Jesus Christ is greater than the circumstance. And the hope of Romans 8 is that nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Even if you have AIDS, you can still come to Christ and find hope and forgiveness in Him.
You are such a good spokesman. I'd love to sit in your Sunday school class. I know
you're
that
welcome.
You have
You're welcome anytime.
One.
We'd love to have you.
Yes,
Christ Community Church. We'd love to have you come.
Okay, well, I will probably do that. He has a new album.
Taking Heaven by Storm.
Why Taking Heaven by Storm?
It's simply Thomas Watson's way of saying be sold out to Jesus Christ in every area of your life. It's taken off of an old Puritan book that was written in the mid-1600s. And I just wanted to write an album after the last one, Consider the Cost, which talked about the gospel, what it means to really follow the Lord, more than just raising a hand, more than signing a decision card. What does it mean to be a true disciple of Christ?
That's right.
And then secondly, once you are, what does it mean in the middle of a dying world, in the midst of our prayer life, in the context of our love relationships and family, on God's ableness and all these things, what does it mean to take heaven by storm, to press into the kingdom of heaven, as Luke would say? And it means just with every fiber of our being to be dedicated to Jesus Christ. So in other words, as the world we see sold out to their sin, we see Madonna dedicated to her depravity,
yes,
in all these areas, I think in many respects she is more sold out to her sin than many Christians are to their Lord.
That's right.
And it ought not to be so. We should be more sold out to Jesus Christ than the world is to its sin. So Taking Heaven by Storm is an encouraging album, I have to say, but it's a little nudge to say, get on with serving the Lord and be more sold out to Him than the world is to a sin.
Well, I don't know what some of our viewers think of contemporary Christian music. Sometimes we have some of the people that are a little fearful of contemporary Christian, and but I hear this excitement, and I want to say to those people, are you as excited as Steve Camp? You are excited about the Lord and the Word.
And you know what? The musical style is not the important thing. When I sing in a church service, I'll sing the ballad, or I'll even sing a hymn if they ask me to. And if I'm in a more of a college setting or whatever, or performing down at like the TPAC or whatever, I can do more of my more up material. The musical style is not really, to me, what's important. The focus is the lyric clear about our faith? Is the person who is singing it living a godly life? Because if we're not, Amos calls it noise to the ears of a holy God.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the wonderful blend to me. And then use the style of the day, as Luther did, as Wesley did,
yes,
to reach those that may not come to church. Use it as the vernacular, the common language of the day, the nomenclature of the time. But at the same time, don't leave behind a Christ-centered message. And that's my burden for us in contemporary Christian music today, that as our industry is growing, that we'll stay deepening in an obedient life to Christ and not leave behind the truth of the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Okay. Thank you so much, Susan. Steve. Will you sing a song for us? Do you have time?
I will be happy to. You know, I usually don't, and if I'm a little nasally and scratchy, you know, most singers don't sing before 7 o'clock at night, but if you'll put up with my scratchy throat this morning, I'll be happy to sing something.
All right. Well, if you'll put up with our ancient piano over
okay.
there,
my ancient voice and that ancient piano will go very well hand in hand this morning.
All right. Steve Camp has an album out, and it's called Taking Heaven by Storm. You can pick it up in any Christian bookstore or just about any record shop. I want you to hear Steve Camp and who he is today.
When you're alone, your heart is torn, He is all you need. When you're confused and your soul is bruised is all you need. He'll be faithful to you, though your heart is untrue, and your love some days turns cold. His forgiveness is real. He can comfort and heal your sin-weary soul. God loves your soul. He'll never let you go. Jesus is all you need. When you give in to that familiar sin, He is all you need. He'll leave you paralyzed. It slowly eats you alive. But He is all you need. He'll be faithful to you. Sin-weary soul, God loves your soul. He'll never let you go. Jesus is all you need.
If you were not here a few minutes ago with us on the air, if you just turned it on, Steve Camp just sang a song called He Is All You Need. Jesus is all you need. When there's nothing else, when there's no one else, you find out He really is all you need. And the lady that's with us today is someone who found out bigger than most of us that you have only Jesus. He really is all you need. And she and her husband, just to capsule what we talked about yesterday, she and her husband, Bill Robinson, went to Lebanon, the country, and spent time over there establishing a children's home. They sold everything they had and took their four children, went over there, started a children's home. And that was their main focus, just to do what the Lord had for them to do. They took in children of all kinds, Lebanese children that were adopted, abandoned, abused, handicapped, whatever. And then they also saw the need for some elderly people to come and live with them. And they were accused of some seditious activities. And Bill Robinson was shot to death in the home that they had established there, while Barbara Robinson and the children, knowing that this was going to happen, sang hymns loud and long to the Lord and knew, all of them, that they were in the will of God. Bill Robinson walked to his death without fighting. He knew that this was God's will. That's why he came there. And but there's more to the story, and we wanted to tell that today. Barbara Robinson is back with me. Also with her is Laverne Barton, a realtor here from Nashville, many of you know. And they are friends. And we've got Barbara just for a short time. And I had a lady at my church come up last night, Barbara, and say, I wish I could hear more of her story. And that was my confirmation that we did the right thing in bringing you back. And what I wanted to get, because we know it's not just events. We don't come in and just talk about how your husband was killed and poor Barbara, or how Barbara got through it, but how this kind of a thing works in a person's life and how telling this story may affect others.
Absolutely. You know, the things that we went through, there are many people in the world that have gone through things like this. There are many people in this country that have gone through things like this and even suffered worse things, much worse things.
Yes.
And so that's really not what we want to talk about, but we want to talk about the things that God has done for us through all these things.
All right. Can you do that? And we need to really focus in because we have maybe only 15, 18 minutes, and I want to make sure they hear all the best part of this. There's so many miracles. I know, Laverne, you were telling us yesterday some of the incredible ways God moved through this.
Yeah.
And between the two of you, I hope that you'll tell that story of how you even got here to America.
Well, it was on a Thursday evening, and a young man came to the door and had a fax, and it was from Laverne to him, and it was about me. And of course, she wanted an answer right away, and so I felt that this really was the Lord moving, and I told him to call Laverne and confirm that I would be there. Of course, I didn't have really enough money to leave the country. I didn't have enough money to really continue on with the work that was there, and I didn't want to leave the home without supplies. In fact, I had less than $9 at the time I got that information. But I knew that the Lord would move in that way. I knew that He would not forget the children if He had prepared this trip for me. And so I just waited and trusted in the Lord, and sure enough, the next day, a check came for $6,000.
From whom?
It came from friends in Finland that had been gathering money together for a number of weeks or maybe even months.
And the Lord knew this?
The Lord knew. Of course, we didn't know anything about it, but God knew, and He had it there on exactly the day that we needed to have it. One thing and another happened, and we got the supplies for the home and whatever, and I made arrangements with people there, with the officials there, that enabled me to come to the United States.
Laverne, how were you involved in bringing her to the United States? You knew some more things that you were telling me out in the lobby yesterday when, when you and Pastor Hardwick started to tell me all the series of events.
Oh.
I want to hear this because this is how God works for the faithful.
Yes.
And let's hear some of that.
It's been really incredible, and we've been marveling at it all week. In June, we received a letter from Barbara saying that it was her heart's desire to see her mom that she had not seen in 10 years, and her mom is well into her 70s. And yesterday, Barbara talked with her brother, who has told her mother that she's coming today.
Oh.
And her mother said, "I didn't think I would ever see her again." And it's wonderful that she's going to be seeing her mother before this day's over.
Mm-hmm.
And we praise the Lord for that. We wrote and asked her if it would be possible for her to join us for the missions conference that our church is having, and that Barbara's presence has contributed to the success of that. Jim Cimbala from the Brooklyn Tabernacle gave us a wonderful sermon on revival, and Barbara's sharing of how she has learned to trust the Lord and walk with the Lord has contributed to just a marvelous missions conference. I mean, our hearts just been so full, it's hard to explain it. We didn't know how important that Barbara's visit would be here. We didn't even really know why we were compelled to try to bring her here, but it was all a part of the Lord's plan for us to have her here with us, because she's blessed us so, and the church has been, they've just opened their hearts to her and loved her so. And I think that she needed that. And that was one of the things that inspired me to write her to start with, was to let her know that the Lord wanted to show her His love through people that she didn't even know. And the Lord does that. And that's the Lord. That's the Holy Spirit. Well, anyway, we asked Barbara if she could come be with us for the missions conference and to see her mom. And in July, fighting broke out in Israel, and it was quite, in Lebanon. It was quite serious. They had to evacuate 500,000 people from southern Lebanon. I can't imagine that kind of exodus. And Barbara's sitting there in the middle of that, and she writes us, "Due to the recent fighting, we've been without electricity, and our generator is down." And I don't know the price of a ticket, and I really don't know how to get that information. But we walk by faith and not by what we see. And just in case the Lord makes a way, here's my picture to recognize me by at the airport, because we'd never seen each other. We've been corresponding for 3 years, but we'd never seen each other before last Thursday evening. And when Barbara stepped off the plane, it was one of the most exciting times of my life. It was so wonderful to see what the Lord had done in bringing her here to be with us. I had tried for a long time, I don't know how long, but we had tried over and over and over to reach Barbara in some way other than mail, because it takes a month for a letter to go back and forth. And we didn't have a month. We just had a very short period of time. So I called and my secretary called over and over and over trying to get an operator in Lebanon to help us reach Barbara. We couldn't get through at all. We started trying to find out how we could make arrangements for Barbara to fly out of Lebanon. The State Department in the U.S. does not allow travel. We couldn't find out if there was we couldn't find out anything. We couldn't get anywhere.
So you're not actually even able to make some kind of a reservation?
Oh, you can't even find out if there's a seat available. The only thing they would tell us is that due to the recent fighting, there were a lot of people leaving the country and that the flights were booked. But they wouldn't tell us if it was possible to get a seat. But now a Canadian travel agency could tell us something. But it was so cumbersome, and we just couldn't seem to get anywhere. We even called the State Department and asked if they would consider making an exception for a missionary to come see her mom that she had not seen in 10 years. No, no, no. Everywhere we went, it was a brick wall. And we were getting very close to the time that we needed her to depart. And so an agent in our office said, well, where is Barbara's hometown? And I said, I don't know, but I do know they left from Winona, Illinois, when they departed for Lebanon. And he said, well, I know the postmaster there. Now, this is a town of only 1,000. What are the chances of that? So he called, and I really didn't think he would find anything out when he called, because people don't live in the same small towns all their lives anymore. We're a very mobile society. 20% of the people move every year, and I just did not.
You probably know better than anybody.
Yes,
as a realtor,
yes. And I just did not think he would find anyone there. But Barbara still has a brother there, and the postmaster knew it. Thank goodness it was a small town.
Mm-hmm. What were some of the other events that led up to this coming that you would tell us, Barbara? Because you don't even think it's miraculous necessarily. It's just kind of everyday business as far as you're concerned.
Well, you know, I think it is a miracle. But at the same time, I think that as Christians, we should expect miracles, because we have a miracle-working God. And I think that for whatever circumstances we're in, when it requires a miracle, God is more than ready and more than able and more than willing to work a miracle for us.
Yes.
When His glory is at stake, He will work a miracle. And I think that that's what this whole thing is about, is to reveal the glory of the Lord to each of us in our own way, so that each one of us personally know that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Yes. How did He work? What were some of the other steps that got you here?
Well,
some of the things that only He could do.
It's so hard for me to separate the things out. Because, you know, I feel like what He's done at this time really comes at the end of just a series of events that happened a long time ago, that began at the time that I was saved.
Yes.
And it's just a part of walking with God.
He had a plan.
Of abiding in Christ, exactly. Mm-hmm. God has a perfect plan for each of us.
Can you see what the end of that plan is, or are you just kind of going along with the walk?
No, you know, I don't know what the end of the plan is, except the end of the plan, I know that we walk into the arms of Jesus.
Yes.
And that could be today, or that could be 40 years from now, or who knows when, or who knows what the circumstances will be.
When your husband was murdered, did you have time to mourn with all the things that you had going on there with 15 children and several elderly people? Did you have time to mourn something for Barbara? Because Barbara gives, gives, gives. But was there something for you?
I think there is a time for mourning, but there's also a time for going on. And you know, when you have more than 30 children in the house, sometimes you have to combine things. There's just not enough hours in the day, so I found that my mourning and my going on had to coincide. And I believe that it was Ezekiel that the Lord spoke to and said that I'm going to take the desire of your heart, but you're to anoint yourself and go speak to the people. And of course, he was a prophet. And to me, that said, I'm going to take Bill, but you are to go on with the work that I've called you to. And I think that that's true for each one of us.
You know, I thought about this last night, that your husband, at 45 years old, had finally given his life totally, fully to the Lord.
Yes.
And knew that he was in the Lord's will to
yes.
go over there to start this home with
yes.
you. And you gave yourselves to that. And then for him to walk easily down the hallway knowing that he was about to be killed. And he did it and knew he was in God's will. Now, somebody would say, well, why did he die? Why was he shot? Who did they think they were? And isn't God in control? What an awful thing to happen. And yet he knew that was his calling, was to die.
He knew that this was exactly what God had called him there for.
Sometimes we're called to do exactly the opposite of what we expect.
Exactly. We don't know what God's plan is for us, but God knows his plan for us. And he says that the things that he's planned for us are for our good.
Yes.
It's for our good and for his glory.
Yes.
And if we put our hand in the Lord's hand, there is nothing in this world that we should fear.
What is the children's home like now?
Well, at this time, you know, we're in smaller quarters, and some of the children have gone. Some of them have gotten older and have gone back to their families or have gone on to other things. Now there are about 15 children in the home, and we have 5 elderly ladies.
They all have their own rooms? Or
No.
What kind of arrangements do you have for these people?
No, we live in a single family dwelling, which means that every room has to double in its purpose. So that means that we have the living room we have converted into a schoolroom, and a bedroom we have converted into a living room. And the dining rooms and the hallways and all of the rooms are bedrooms, because at night we take a mattress and put them on the floor, and it's just like having a big slumber party every night. And then in the daytime, the mattresses are all stacked up in one of the rooms. And you know, we only have one bathroom.
Oh my goodness.
We only have one bathroom.
You know, we talked yesterday about the possibility of you, maybe the Lord is wanting to open this up with your heart and your simplicity and your servanthood. Maybe the Lord is trying to give you a larger children's home. Is that something you would want?
It would be wonderful. It would be wonderful to have a permanent place for the children.
Are there a lot of children over there that just have nowhere to go?
Well, you know, now we're talking about in the southernmost part of the country, in an area that's known as the Israeli Security Zone.
Mm-hmm.
We're not talking about a big city. We're talking about a very small area. In that area, there really are no facilities for families to take their handicapped children. There are no orphanages right within that small area. There are places in the other parts of the country, but you know, travel is sometimes difficult, and it's hard to be separated from your children. And if you can get help nearby, it would be nice. We do try to help, and of course, there's no way that we can begin to meet the needs of all the children and the families that are there. So we are very limited.
No, it's, I know you're going to go see your mother today.
Yes.
And you're going to be in the country how long? How long
for probably about a month.
Okay. But you opted to stay there.
Yes.
Afterward.
Yes, and, it's home.
Okay. And you're staying there with and for the children, and your children's home, does it have a name or is it just a home?
Well, we just call ourselves Christian Children's Home.
Okay.
We're really not an organization, but we just call ourselves Christian Children's Home, just as a point of reference, really, for people.
Okay. I want to thank you for coming back, and because I didn't want to leave it. We left it right at the end there that he was murdered, and I think some people may have thought, what good is there
Yes.
in somebody killing a man
Yes.
like that? But the good is something I think you've explained a little bit to
and
us.
And that's
today.
Not the end of things. That's Yeah. not the end.
No. No, and maybe it's a beginning in some ways for Barbara telling that story, just enough maybe to strengthen our faith. And God bless you for that.
Thank you very
You've
much.
You sure helped me.
Thank you
right.
very
Thank
much.
Thank you, Laverne, for coming on the show. If you would like to help in some way or find out more about Barbara Robinson's children's home, the Christian Children's Home in Lebanon, you can write to us here or call 754-0039. I'll be glad to find out what information I can for you or put you in touch with them. And we're about out of time today. I have been so blessed. I hope that you have been blessed. And for those of you that are just finding us this time of the morning, you got up very late and missed a lot of good stuff this morning. Steve Camp was on earlier, and of course, Barbara. And we'll be back with you tomorrow with Christian comic Joe Gaucher. He's coming back. He's got a lot of new things happening in his life, and he's funny as ever, and still writes great music. Also, from Marriage Encounter, we have Gary and Lisa Morris that'll be with us. And remember, we're on Viacom now, so if you're watching us on 39 and you want to see us on Viacom, just turn over to channel 21. 39 has come of age. We're 21 on Viacom, and we'll see you tomorrow on the Morning Edition.